Hello and welcome. You're watching Head to Head. I'm Carrie Oderman with UATV. A whopping 71% of Ukrainians are satisfied with President Volodymyr Zelensky's policy, as shown by a survey result published by the rating group Pollster on September 21st. This is a level which no other president has ever enjoyed. Public confidence in the success of his reforms is at its highest since 2015. With the election of Volodymyr Zelensky as president, people began to ratchet up their expectations for political and economic reforms, specifically those propelled by Western-oriented initiatives. To talk more about the current political climate in Ukraine and more, we welcome to our studio today Dr. Olga Onuch, Associate Professor in Politics at the University of Manchester, Associate Member of Nuffield College. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
International relations is an up and down lately. Things that weren't normal in the past are now the norm. You study the Ukrainian voter in some ways.
Yeah.
What can you tell us about the Ukrainian citizens' voting behavior?
Well, last time I was here, I was talking about the results of the parliamentary election, and now we are a few months out, and 71% approval rating is extremely high. And so I think that's something that people need to, again, take on board, that at least in the image of this president, voters are in line with him, and voters are supporting what he's doing, and they're satisfied with it. I think very few presidents can say that in Ukrainian history. When it comes to some of the more focus on the international component or neighbors, I think Ukrainians want the same thing. They want the support of their Western partners, specifically the US and the EU, in maintaining sanctions. That actually happens to be also quite highly supported by the Ukrainian electorate.
Okay, you know the saying, the bigger they are, the harder they fall. If he has a 71% approval rating, can it go up? Or are we going to see perhaps if he isn't able to have the quick turnaround with some of his new reforms that have gone quite quickly, if he can't keep that momentum, which is a breakneck speed, what might happen?
Yeah, you've touched on some very important things. Of course, Putin has managed to keep his rating up quite high, and then it fell. No, I don't think he can keep it this high for too long. And probably this rating will go down significantly. We'll see when and how exactly. But when it comes to this speed of passing reforms, we've only had a few days of the Rada being active, and we have seen this huge amount of laws being just pushed through. And even in one case, they wanted to pass a law that would speed up the process of going through laws in parliament. I think there's a lot of people looking at this with, skepticism, I think, is not even the right word. People are a little bit scared that things are happening too quickly.
Because he has the absolute majority with the Servant of the People Party, he can push through everything, but there is a value in democratic society with having a healthy opposition.
Yeah.
They can add things to legislation and policy which the people in the absolute majority might not have thought of, actually improving the health of the legislation.
Absolutely. Democracy is nothing if not about processes. And if we're taking out, which I think some of the observers have been saying this week, if we take out the debate out of parliament, then this parliament is not, it's a rubber stamp rather than this institution that's supposed to provide a check and a balance to the presidency. And of course in Ukraine, the constitutional issues around this are quite complicated, but certainly this majority, that the 251 deputies in the Rada is, we've never seen it before, but also they haven't voted in entire unity this week. So even in one case, and specifically the law that would speed up the process of getting another law through, only 208 out of the 251 voted for that. Now, to me, that is a signal probably more worrying than the rubber stamping, because that means there's an instability in this party. And even a small group that's connected to someone else might become kingmakers of future majorities for laws.
I'm worried about that myself, because a lot of these politicians are the first time in the Rada, don't have the training, maybe were a little bit, I don't want to say naive, but inexperienced, and now they're getting to see the ropes, and they don't like to be told perhaps what to do, especially because there wasn't much of a ideology behind Servant of the People. It was to come in and break down the system But now they're part of the system. Are they going to start playing the games?
I think they already are. I think that law that people kind of have glazed over because it doesn't seem to be very significant is quite telling already. And I think people need to look at who voted how and then try to analyze that, because not everyone is fully brand new. There are people connected to various groups, whether political, economic, or otherwise, private sector and NGOs and so on. So it's interesting to see who doesn't vote with the party in those cases. But yeah, I think that this is the instability of a party that is in majority is quite worrying to me, because I don't know then what happens thereafter. And I think maybe that should be a little bit more worrying also to some of the observers. But the speed, I think most Ukrainian citizens have no idea what laws are being passed.
Can't keep track of it. As someone in the media, it's hard to even keep track to report on it. We're going to have to pivot away from that for a little bit and talk about why you're here. You're here for the YES conference. Tell us what YES stands for, and we're going to talk about happiness next.
Right. So YES is the Yalta European Strategy, and it used to take place in Crimea. And of course, in 2014, it was moved here to Kyiv. And so this is this getting together of politicians, academics, practitioners of various kinds to discuss some of the most important strategic issues facing Ukraine and the world more broadly. This year, the theme is happiness, and that may or may not be understood in the same ways to different people. It's probably not happiness in the way that we would speak about it colloquially. It's not this subjective happiness, emotional happiness that we are talking about. It's about satisfaction with life. And Finland happens to be the happiest country in the world currently. And we actually heard from Finnish politicians today. And I think there's a reason for that. It's because people have a sense of security. The state provides an understanding that the state will be there when you need an education, that the state will provide good roads, that the state will provide a social network that will protect you should you need it. That's the kind of measurement of happiness that I think the conference team was thinking of. I think it might get lost in the messaging somewhere.
So when we talk about 70% and more happiness, satisfaction with President Zelensky and his new administration, are we talking about the same thing that was discussed at the conference?
Well, I mean, that's an approval measure. So whether people are happy, they're satisfied with, they approve. They're not even satisfied. They approve of what he's done so far. They might not be satisfied with the outcomes. They might still want more. So that could be a different issue. I think when it comes to satisfaction in Ukraine and the things that President Zelensky talked about today as well, but more broadly, some of the social science here, is that people need to be able to live not necessarily a comfortable, but a secure life. And security, both economically and physical security in Ukraine, is a threat that people deal with on a daily basis.
So it really is in President Zelensky's best interest to make sure that some of these basic infrastructure issues are taken care of and addressed.
Absolutely.
However, probably not as quickly as he'd like, because these things do take time to happen, right?
Yeah, and he actually said that today in his speech. He said, I want things done, and I want them done fast, but I'm probably going to make some mistakes. I think when they're really important things, whether they are infrastructural things or the sale of land in Ukraine, agricultural land, this is something that can't be done fast, or the mistakes might be catastrophic and might have much worse effects, certainly on the lives of ordinary citizens in Ukraine, but also on the Ukrainian economy and stability of the country. Yeah.
All right, let's talk about who President Zelensky is meeting with. William Taylor from the U.S. Embassy said that President Zelensky may meet with U.S. President Trump sometime at the end of September, but not in Washington at the White House, in New York. Is this something that Ukrainians should wonder about?
I think we're all wondering about it, because we usually would expect a head of state to come to D.C., and there would be some pomp and circumstance that also we would expect to see. I think this is more about the Trump administration and our inability to predict what the Trump administration does. We don't know who necessarily is calling the shots on many things currently. So we don't know exactly, is this an affront to Zelensky? I wouldn't go so far to say that, but this is certainly not the most typical way to greet. But I think for Zelensky, for Ukraine, it's important that they meet.
I think it's important that they meet too, but you never know what's going to come out. In July, President Zelensky met with President Macron. They looked like best buddies. Now, at the G7 afterwards, Macron was leaning towards Putin. We know that President Trump has the reputation of also leaning towards Vladimir Putin. What will they discuss at the meeting, Zelensky and Trump?
Oh, gosh, I wouldn't dare to say what they're going to discuss, but I do hope they discuss the maintenance of sanctions. And I think that is top priority for Zelensky and certainly for the crowd here in Kyiv. And the U.S. needs to be, they need to be front and center in this without Trump's support to back the sanctions and continue to back the sanctions. So whatever needs to happen there. I hope that they also discuss the Minsk Treaty and the how things can go forward. Is there an opportunity for further talks? What will those talks entail? Who will be sitting at the table? These are the things that I think can be decided, at least initially, in such a meeting.
Can I interrupt? What do you think about the Normandy format? As it is, with the core four, there's been the discussion of adding UK and the US to it. Is that going to be helpful?
Quite frankly, I think at this point, trying new things might be helpful.
Okay.
Yeah. I think two things are here important. The U.S. has always been very supportive of Ukraine. Now, with Bolton leaving the White House, who was perceived to be a critic of Putin's, a critic of Russia, and certainly a hawk in American political terms, that might be a problem for Ukraine. Hawks are actually good for Ukraine and certainly...
And predictable.
And also the UK has been a very important supporter of Ukraine and partner, and certainly in the war as well, in supporting the military in various ways. But the UK is going through its own thing. There's no way that they're going to get involved in this, I don't think.
Do you really think so? Because the UK is looking at trade deals. Ukraine exports the most food and the UK buys the most food.
Right.
So there's that relationship that could be happening. We've had a lot of business people coming in. It might be in their interest. I'm watching this.
I certainly think that will be in the interest. And there's a parliamentary group in Westminster that deals with trade with Ukraine, and that has never left their agenda. I think getting involved in the various negotiations to peace might not be something that's a priority for Boris.
But not for Boris, maybe.
Well, he's still in power now, so yeah.
But, you know, there's a common denominator there with the Skripal affair.
Yeah.
And I think the UK, other than maybe the Netherlands, understands what Russia is capable beyond their borders of, much like Ukraine. So then we have that to work with.
I think you are absolutely right. I think involving the UK sooner might have been even a better strategy. I'm just living in Manchester, watching the daily news and my colleagues who work on British politics, I don't personally, but it is in complete disarray. I don't think I've ever seen, well, certainly not the United Kingdom, but ever seen a Western industrialized democracy behave in this way, where you're shutting down Parliament for a period of time and, you know, they were debating things until 2 a.m. Just a few days ago on the last day of Parliament. So I think the UK has its own major problems that seem to be something that they cannot resolve. So I don't know. I wouldn't put my money on that, but I'm certainly... It's very likely that I'm wrong on this one. Would it be helpful? Perhaps. These have both been very supportive and important partners for Ukraine. So, yeah.
Well, it's reassuring that an expert like you just kind of sits there and watches with popcorn, too, because the rest of us don't seem to be able to guess what's going to happen either.
Yeah.
What advice, to round off our interview, would you like to give the Zelensky administration?
Oh, gosh. Yeah, the advice. I think slowing down the process in the Rada and demonstrating that they respect the checks and balances that are in place and respect the democratic process, which does involve giving a space for debate, even if that debate is not going to lead to a different outcome, it still needs to be had.
The process is important.
The process is important. I think that's key. But at the same time, I think there's a lot of people who are against Zelensky and his team just because they are in favor of someone else. And that might not be the best way to go forward. So I would hope that they also persevere on some of the more important propositions that they made during the electoral campaigns, which there were some. And I think putting the Ukrainian voter front and center is something that needs to happen a little bit more. Just on my way here into the studio, my taxi driver, who came from, happens to have come from Kryvyi Rih, right, telling me the story of how he came here 3 months ago. People are struggling. And I keep saying this, and people say, well, no, poverty has declined. If you start adjusting some of these statistics, that's not the case. And people are struggling to get by. People are making choices not to buy meat so that they can pay
for their... And having one, two, and three jobs.
Yeah. Right. This is what needs to happen now. And I think if the Zelensky team is able to do that in earnest while respecting the democratic process, I think they will have supporters. If they're not able to do that, then they're going to be out the next time around, just like any other Ukrainian president or politician that has failed.
Well, yeah. Let's hope someone's watching and takes your advice.
Right.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
That was Dr. Olga Onuch, Associate Professor in Politics at the University of Manchester, Associate Member of Nuffield College. Thank you for watching, and stay tuned for more.